Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Old Testament Survey, our second class. If there's anybody, welcome Area Sisters. You weren't here last week.
No.
If you're interested in getting the book, we have some more of the books. I didn't bring them in here right now, but at the break I can get them. They're the Nelson Book of Bible Charts and Maps, but it actually is a great introduction to every book of the Bible, outline the whole thing. And if you don't have it, it's 250 pesos, so a heck of a deal. It's less than the retail price. And be happy to provide those if you're interested. Okay? Let's open. This is more of an academic setting than a Bible study setting, but still open with the word of prayer. So let's pray together. Father, thank you for your grace in allowing us to be here to study your word. We pray that you would guide us by your Holy Spirit as we study the Old Testament. Give us a sense of the foundation that you have prepared since the creation of the world for having your will worked out throughout all history. We seek to learn more of you and to grow closer because of it. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, Old Testament survey. You'll notice that this is happening in 2016, not 2017. Last week I had the wrong dates on things. I don't know why. I was writing a bunch of stuff for a client about events in 2017, and I ended up putting that on all the charts. So today we are going to be talking about, last week we did introduction. Today we actually start talking about the Old Testament itself. Remember the Tanakh, as it's called in the Hebrew. It's called the Tanakh because there are three main sections in Hebrew. Those sections are the Torah, the first five books, the Nevi'im, which are the prophets, and the Ketuvim, which are the writings. The writings is Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, etc. So, is that a comment on my teaching? So if you take Torah, the books of Moses, Nevi'im, the prophets, and Ketuvim, the writings, and you take the first letters and push them together, you get Tanakh. And so that's why it's called the Tanakh, or sometimes the Mikra, which means that which is read. So that's what we're starting on the beginning of that. So today we want to start talking about the first five books. We're going to start talking about these today. We're going to especially emphasize the first book, Genesis. The first five books of the Old Testament are the, in Hebrew it's called the Torah, which means, usually it's translated law. Instruction is probably a better idea, because when we hear law, we think judges and courts and policemen and all that. It's not that. It's an instruction about the things of God. But it's referred to as the law by the Jewish people, the law of Moses. These are called the books of Moses because Moses is the traditional author of all five of these books, which is, when we get into them a little bit further, we'll talk about that. I believe he was the author of these books, with the addition of other divinely anointed writers, like perhaps Joshua, who clearly was a man of God and chosen by God, may have been the one who came in later and added the parts about Moses' death and burial. Or it could be that Moses was given a divine, you know, insight into what his death and burial was going to be. We don't know. But they are called the books of Moses, Hebrew, Torah, law, or instruction. They're also called the Pentateuch. Pentateuch is Greek. Torah is Hebrew. Pentateuch is Greek. And Pentateuch means the five books or the five-part book. It's probably more accurate. Five books or five-part books. Five-part book. Penta means five, right? Pentagram, pentagon. And then tuch is a book. So Pentateuch, the five-part book.
Pentateuch is a book, and
you have that. So when we talk about the Torah, the law, the five books, or it's referred to in Hebrew as the five-fifths of Moses, because those five together are the whole of the books of Moses. The five books are, of course, Genesis. In Hebrew, that's Bereshit, which means in the beginning. Quite common in the Old Testament books, and in fact a lot of ancient documents, they would name them based upon the first words, whatever the first words were. So in the beginning are the first words of Genesis, and so in Hebrew that's Bereshit. We get the name Genesis from the Greek word genesios, which means the history of origins. So it is the book of beginnings, the book of origins. The second book, of course, is the Exodus, the Ve'alei Shemot. That means here are the names of in Hebrew. In Greek, we get Exodus, which means exit. I said before, if you go to Greece, to any place where they speak Greek, and you see an exit sign, you'll be able to tell, even though it's in Greek letters, it looks like Exodus. That's what exit means. So when we were on Patmos, the island that John, the Apostle John, wrote Revelation on, we were at the monastery of St. John, and there's big signs over all the doors, Exodus, you know. and you could read them, whether you knew Greek letters or not. So the third of the books, of course, is Leviticus from Vayikra, which is, and the Lord called in Hebrew. From the Greek, Leviticus means relating to the Levites. Leviticus is the book that gives us a lot of the legal, the priestly legalities about sacrifice of animals and all that sort of things, the priestly duties. And so Leviticus means relating to the Levites in Greek. The fourth of the five-fifths of Moses, or the Pentateuch, is the book of Numbers, Bemidbar, which means in the desert. Numbers is about the desert wanderings of the Hebrew people after the giving of the law. From the Greek, this Numbers here refers to the census list. There's twice in the book of Numbers where they count the people, in chapter 1 and chapter 26. And so Numbers is what this book is called, because it refers to counting of the people. And then Deuteronomy, which is Halei Hadabarim. These are the words from Greek. Deuteronomy, deutero, means second. And the onomy part of it is a reference to the law. So it's the second repetition of the law. What happens is, of course, after the Exodus, when the people don't have faith that God can really have them take the promised land because there are walled cities and giants in the land, only Moses and Joshua and Caleb believed that they could take it, take the land. And so because of that, the Hebrew people, God led them to wander in the wilderness for 40 years, which is how long it took all of the male leaders of the families to die, with the exception of Moses, Joshua, and Caleb. And that's after the old generation had died. Deuteronomy was the second telling of the law, because it was a repeating of the law for the benefit of the younger generation that was now the ones that were going to go into the promised land. Okay? So these are the first five books of the Bible, the first five books of the Tanakh, the Moses, the books of Moses, the Pentateuch, the Torah. Pick a name. Okay, they all mean the same thing. Any questions about that? Julia, I saw you sort of...
Well, I can't help it. In the dessert.
Oh, yes. I did that on purpose.
That was a test, wasn't it? To see who would find it.
Right.
It's probably a subconscious thing. When I lived in Pasadena, California, I went to seminary there. If you know what conceptual art is, it's sort of where you... Anyway, there was a building, and on the side of the building, do you know the great... saying by T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, my people are the people of the desert. You know, it was his way of saying he had become like a Bedouin. Well, on the side of this building it said, in quotes, my people are the people of the desert, said T.E. Lawrence, picking up his fork. Sorry, desert. It means in the desert, not in the dessert. Any real questions?
Okay. That's not all we have.
Yeah, that's it. So, these five books, let's look at what they cover. Genesis is from creation, the creation of the universe, and of people, then through the origins of God's people, the Hebrew people, and to their entry into Egypt, when Joseph was the chief operating officer, so to speak, of Egypt. They all went into Egypt. It's before their slavery, but that's the book of Genesis. Covers from the creation of the universe to the entry of the Jewish people into Egypt under Joseph. The book of Exodus then relates how after they had become slaves in Egypt, there arose a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. They became slaves, and Exodus is the story of God's deliverance of Israel from Egypt, and then the establishing of his covenant law. So he calls Moses out of his sort of self-imposed exile, to go back to Egypt, where he had come from, lead the people out of captivity, and then to give them the law at Mount Sinai. All right? That's the story of Exodus. Leviticus sets forth the laws of worship, especially the Levitical aspects of it. We think of when we say commandments, we think there are 10 commandments. There's actually in the Torah, there are 613 commandments. In Hebrew, they're called mitzvot. You know, there's the Big Ten, but then there are a lot of other commandments, particularly related to the Levitical law, how the priests were supposed to act and how they and what the people were supposed to do in obedience to that, down to fine details like, you know, how many legs had to be on the stool you were seated on, and whether you could eat out of a bowl that had a lip versus a bowl that didn't have a lip, and all kinds of stuff like that. Okay, not eating bacon, not eating shellfish. Then the book of Numbers, as we've said, relates to the wilderness wandering and the counting of the people early and then late in that process. And Deuteronomy gives the law to a new generation with special emphasis on preparation for entering the land. All right? Questions? Yes?
Did the people know exactly where they were going?
No. Yeah. They originally had come from that area. I mean, Abraham, when he was called, when he was first Abram, was called out, and we'll look at this later, was called out of Ur of the Chaldees, it's called, which is down in Mesopotamia, in modern-day Iraq. And he traveled up to Haran, where his father died, and then he traveled down into the area that's been called Palestine, the Levant. And I'll show you some images so you can see what that looks like in a minute. And they had lived there for several generations. And then there's Abraham, Isaac, and then Jacob and Esau. It was under Jacob that a famine hit the land, and Joseph had already been sold into slavery and was down in Egypt doing very well. And then they went down there. So the expectation may very well have been that we're going back to the original place, but they didn't know that for sure. God had said, I will give you a place, a land to be your own. But, you know, he could have sent them back to Ur of the Chaldees for all they probably knew. I don't think they understood. Now, that is up until the time of the spies.
Right.
Because when Moses sent out the 12 spies, they went into the Holy Land, what we call the Holy Land, and came back and reported on it. So they had that expectation. But, you know, when they first came out of Egypt and God said, I will, you know, I'm going to fulfill my promise to give you a land, I don't think they were sure that it was going to be Palestine. Yeah, there's no good word to use. Palestine was not the name of that area until after the Romans destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. They renamed it Palestine, which is kind of a messed up version of Philistine, because the Philistines lived in the cities along the coast, Tyre and Sidon. And so the Romans called that the province of Palestine after the Philistines. So whether you call it the Levant or the Holy Land or whatever, the definitions, you know, depends on what time you're talking about, and that makes it kind of awkward. So if you ever have a question what I'm referring to when I talk about that, ask me, because there are different words at different times. Yes?
Okay, when I was looking at the book, and it showed Adam as 4,000 BC, approximately, for the creation of man, is not necessarily what we consider 4,000. It could have been longer than that, because a lot of the people, non-believers especially, will say, well, if Adam was created 4,000 BC, and the earth is millions of years old.
Well, people who say that Adam was created 4,000 BC, that creation occurred only somewhere between 6,000 and 10,000 years ago, would not say the world is millions and billions of years old. The traditional view is that the universe is 13.8 billion years old, and that the earth is about 4.5 billion years old, and that this is the scientific belief, and that human beings are 3.5 billion years old, or something like that. We're going to talk about that. There are six different theories about creation and when it occurred and how it occurred. And so we're going to get to that a little bit later today. But yeah, that's in fact, when I put up a time chart earlier, when I was talking about when the different books occurred and everything else, I had question mark, Adam, 4,400 BC, question mark, you know.
That's
because, there's a lot of questions, but we'll talk about that. You know, the different theories about that, how we're supposed to interpret it. By people who still believe that, you know, at least four of those theories are people who still believe that God was involved in the process. You know, they're not all pagan, and yet there's some disagreement about that. Okay? All right, let's start talking about the books that we're going to talk about today, and it's the book of Genesis. again, the book of beginnings or of origins. We believe the author was Moses, and remember at the end of last week I talked about the documentary hypothesis, which would say Moses couldn't have written this for all the reasons I talked about last week, most of which have been debunked. For instance, they believe Moses couldn't have written, would not have known how to write. Well, we've since then found many examples of people being able to write well before Moses' time. And if he was raised as the adopted son of Pharaoh's daughter, then he would have had the best education available, because that was the time when Egypt was the dominant power on earth. And so there's a lot of the premises that they had, that they used to argue that Moses couldn't possibly have written the book, don't hold anymore. And in the absence of specific evidence, in the presence of specific evidence, we believe what Scripture says, and that is that these are the books of Moses. We believe they were written around 1450 to 1400 B.C. Remember, count backwards, if you're in B.C. And that was 1400 or so was the period of time of the entrance into the Promised Land. More modern scholars would, if they believe that there was an entrance into the Promised Land at all, they put it probably 200 years or so later than that. But a weird example of the circular kind of logic you run into. And I believe in scholarship. I believe in science. I believe God gave us a brain to use. But an example of circular logic was I was watching one of the great courses. You know the great courses that teach a company. You get these videos that are all these topics. And I really like them. I've used a lot of them, a lot of material. There was one by a woman who's an archaeologist, and whose name is Jody Magnus. And she started out by saying it's not possible that she questions whether there was an entry into the Holy Land anyway. And she said, and it's certainly not possible it could have happened at the traditional date around 1400. But then a short time later, she's talking about how the falling of the walls of Jericho couldn't have existed when Joshua and the Israelites traditionally came in, because she said in 1250 there were no walls around Jericho. The walls had been destroyed 150 to 250 years before that. And I'm going, wait a minute, back up. First you say they couldn't have done it at that time, and then you say it couldn't have happened because the walls fell at exactly the time traditionally they were supposed to have fallen with Joshua. And I said, this is a circular logic. You're using two false arguments to try to support one another. That if she has problems with when the walls of Jericho fell, apply the traditional date, and it's exactly on target. So, anyway, you get a lot of that kind of stuff. But the tradition is that around 450 to 1400 BC was the time of the writing of the book of Genesis, as it was written during Moses' life and during the time between when he was called by God to go back into during the wilderness wanderings is when he would have written it, because that's when he had time. But it had to be obviously after the Exodus and the giving of the law and prior to the entrance into the Promised Land. Theme is beginnings of the universe, of the human race, of the Jewish people. The purpose is to show that the Creator God is sovereign and that He loves His creation. Again, people who think that the Old Testament is all about judgment and law and justice and an angry God and all that have not bothered to read it. It really is a story of God's love for His people and the fact that no matter how badly they acted, no matter how many times they betrayed Him, they did have to be punished for things, just like, well-raised children sometimes have to be punished for things. But He would love them and call them back. And so it is a demonstration of God's sovereignty and His love of creation. There are two major sections to the book of Genesis. And my goal in this course is that by the time we're done, you'll have a good sense of the major books, what the big pieces are. And in Genesis, the thing you need to remember is that the first 11 chapters, which is called the primal history or the prehistoric prologue, talk about that, because these are very ancient events. There are four events in there. There is the story of creation, the story of the fall, the story of the flood and Noah, and the story of the Tower of Babel. Now, the importance of those stories, it's not possible to overestimate the value of those. It tells us how everything came to be, what is wrong with human beings, that God does judge sin, the whole story of the flood. He judged sins, but He always maintains a remnant. and why it is that the world is such a confused place. So basically the whole background, ethos, environment, all the context for human existence are established in the first 11 chapters. Then, starting at the end of the 11th chapter, we get introduced to the Hebrew people. Actually, the Hebrew people started out as just two people, Abram and Sarai. Now, it's common in both the Old and New Testament that when something changes, something significant of a spiritual nature changes in someone's life, their name changes. Abram, who is, that's how we're introduced to him at first, means exalted father. God promised him that if he's obedient, that God would make him the father of a great nation. And so he renamed him Abraham, which means father of many. So the name change reflected God's promise. Sarai, his wife, got her name changed to Sarah, which is what we know her by. And so up until the time when those name changes happened, it was Abram and Sarai. So Father Abraham, we have chapter 11 to 25. Then the first son of Abraham is introduced in there, Ishmael. But Ishmael was not Sarah's son. It was Hagar, Sarah's handmaid. We talk about that. But the son of the covenant was Isaac, the second child of Abraham. So Father Abraham and then Isaac and Isaac's son Jacob, his other son Esau. And then Jacob's 12 sons, who are the 12 tribes of Israel, because Jacob gets his name changed to Israel. Don't be confused by all that. We're going to get into some detail. I'm just giving you the upfront stuff. So Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph are the four primary patriarchs. Joseph was the 11th of Jacob's children, but he was the one that God uniquely used to manifest his will by him going into Egypt and all of that. So, first 11 chapters, the prehistoric prologue with the four great events of creation, fall, flood, and Tower of Babel. Then, from chapter 11 through chapter 50, you get the story of the Hebrew people with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 sons of Jacob who became the 12 tribes of Israel, and especially Joseph. Okay? That's the outline for the whole book. And then a lot of stories and details in between. That make sense? This lays it out for you as well. One way to think about it is that in Genesis 1 to 11, the primeval history or the prehistoric prologue, that events predominate. It's mostly about events, not about specific people. We get creation in the first two chapters, fall in chapters 3, 4, and 5, the flood in chapters 6 through 9, and then the Tower of Babel, the confusion of languages, in chapters 10 and 11. On the end of, again, Abraham is introduced at the very end of chapter 11. So Genesis 12 to 50, people predominate. It is the story not of events, but of people primarily. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. And the first prehistoric prologue addresses the needs of all of humanity, or the situation of all of humanity. And we are all affected by the fall, for instance. And the family of Abraham, the Hebrew people, are the focus of chapters 12 to 50. In the first part, an unknown number of years. It depends upon where you put the creation point. We don't know. That's why it's the prehistoric prologue. It's before we were writing history, per se. And then there's 300 years in the chapters 12 to 50, which is the story of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and his sons. Okay? You know to stop me if you have any questions. So, what are the key messages from Genesis? There are four primary messages. One, Genesis tells us that God created from nothing, or ex nihilo, everything that is. God is the creator God, and that's how everything got started, is God chose to do it. Secondly, Genesis explains to us what's wrong with humanity, why we're confused, broken, lost, self-destructive, and unable to communicate. Then, Genesis tells... Yes?
No, it just... Sad. It's very sad. Yeah.
What's that?
We're very sad.
Yeah. We're pretty sorry creatures.
Yeah.
Weren't intended to be that way, but we ended up that way. Then Genesis tells us the consequences for disobedience and betrayal, especially betrayal of God's love. There is judgment. And then it tells us the story of God's call and his blessing on the people of Israel, the children of Abraham, as a sign of his love for all humanity. Now, the reason it's a sign of love for all of humanity is that when God calls Abraham and says, if you obey me and go where I send you, then three things will happen. I will make of you a great people, even though he was too old to have kids, he thought, he and Sarah. Both. I'll usually refer to them as Abraham and Sarah, because that's what we're used to. But you will be the father of a great nation. In fact, he was the father of two nations, or two peoples, because his first son by Hagar, Ishmael, is the father of the Arabic peoples. And so, I will make of you a great people, I will give you a land for to be your very own, which is the promised land, that's why it's called that. And the third one is, through you I will bless all the peoples of the earth. So at the same time that God was saying, you, Abraham, will be the start of my special people, my chosen people, my elect, and why he chose an elderly couple and then a nomadic sort of wandering small tribe of people. Even today, there's only verified 14 million Jews in the world. They're not a big population even today. Why he would do that instead of Egypt or Acadia, which was the first great empire under Sargon, I'm going to mention Sargon later, or the Assyrians or the Babylonians or the Hittites or one of those others that were major world powers, why he chose this little group of people. They call that the scandal of exclusivity. But God always said, even though you are my special people, through you I will bless all the peoples of the earth. He said that to Abraham. He said it again when he passed on the blessing to Isaac. God said to Isaac, through you I will bless all the peoples. He said that to Jacob. So he reiterates that promise that they would be the source through whom all the peoples of the earth would be blessed, even though they were part of the small, chosen, select people of God. Okay? So that's why it's a sign of his love for all humanity. Questions?
When I was young, I wish I had known all this when I was young. I was traveling with this Jewish New Yorker, and he proceeded to tell me, I was pontificating on it, and he proceeded to tell us he was the chosen because he's Jew, and the rest of us. And I just sat there, my mouth dropped, like, well, that's not what I'm learning in Sunday school. But I could hear him get the back of that, and I'm like, oh, if I could just make the beginning.
Yes. Well, and in addition to that, they are the chosen people, but Paul is very clear in Romans that we are adopted into that family. We are honorary Jewish people. He says we are grafted onto the rootstock of the Jewish people, and that's how we inherit the promise that he had made to his chosen people, the Jews. Okay.
That's not how we refer to it.
So here, some major parallels in world history. So you get some idea when did this happen in the context of everything else happening. Okay, some major world events. Genesis is from circa, little c with a period, that means circa, which means about, or as best we know. It's probably a better way to explain it. As best we know, Abraham was about 2100 BC, and then Joseph's death was about 1805. Remember I said there was about 300 year period. From verse chapter 11 into chapter 11 to chapter 50. 3700 BC is the best date we have for when the wheel was invented, probably in Sumer. That's the oldest civilization. The Sumerian civilization is the oldest one in history, even before the Egyptians. Egyptian was probably second. And that was in Mesopotamia. The word Mesopotamia means the land between the rivers. I'm going to show you a map next. And the rivers were the Tigris and the Euphrates. Remember the story of creation. That the Tigris and Euphrates rivers are mentioned as being watering the lands that the Garden of Eden was in. So we'll talk about that too. Yes?
So Adam was about 4000 BC? Is that what is in the book?
Well, yes, that's the...
Yeah. Right. So now we've got like 300 years until the wheel is invented.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, right. I don't think that Adam lived 4,000 years ago, or 4,000 BC rather. So 6,000 years ago. I think it's longer than that. And we'll talk about
it. I'm getting things in my head.
Yep. Yep.
So right. I have to have something.
Right. The young earth creationists, the people who would say that the earth is less than 10,000 years old, probably somewhere between 6,000 and 7,000 years old, they would say that yes, Adam was somewhere in the, you know, in the 4,000s, and so the wheel was only invented a few hundred years after that. They would say that. I don't agree with that timing. I mean, I don't doubt when the wheel was made, but I think Adam was early in that. We'll talk
about that.
Yes?
I've never been to the Middle East, but I think of all of those places over there, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, as basically desert and deserted. But I'm looking at the Tigris and Euphrates, and there's some other rivers, and Genesis, I think, mentions a couple of others. Was all of this a different environment then than it is today? Or are there places over there in the Tigris and Euphrates area that are very lush and as we would picture Eden?
Yes and yes. In fact, you remember that God promised the Israelites when the promised land was a land of flowing milk and honey. And yet, what do the pictures look like that you've seen of Israel?
It's not milk and honey.
Yeah,
exactly.
Looks like desert, dry rocks,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, the reason is because even in a relatively small area, Israel, for instance, there is a spine of rock that runs north-south and alongside the Jordan River. Mm-hmm. Jordan River connects the Sea of Galilee in the north and the Red Sea in the south. And that spine of rock is where Jerusalem was built and where a lot of the cities were built. Between that spine of rock and the Mediterranean Sea is the plain of Sharon, which is a great agricultural area. So the plain of Sharon is, and there's a couple of other valleys along there too, that are great agricultural areas. And that undoubtedly was what they were talking about when they said it's a land full of milk and honey. You will remember the story is that when the spies came back, they had a bunch of grapes so big it took two men to carry it on a pole between them, you know. So there's a lot of fertile growth and stuff. Well, when the Israelites took the promised land, they didn't take it all. You know, they stopped short. They got enough land for them to settle on, and they didn't take the rest of it. And the part that they did take was not the best part. And so that's part of what the reason why we have, you know, cities and stuff. It's also the cities were built up on higher places. Well, the higher places are the places that are rocky and sandy and all of that kind of stuff. The same thing is true in Mesopotamia. There were times when it was almost all very fertile. In fact, irrigation was invented there. And that whole area was irrigated and fertile until the Mongols came through. In our history, we don't often think about Genghis Khan and the Mongols and all those things. They destroyed all the irrigation systems. They were quite unique amongst the various empires of the world, and the Mongolian Empire is probably the biggest one that's ever existed. People don't even think about that. Bigger even the Roman Empire, because it stretched from China all the way into Europe. And for some reason, you know, their culture was they didn't want to settle down. They were nomadic and they wanted to stay nomadic. They rode horses, they built yurts, they had herds. So they would roll through a place like Mesopotamia and just destroy everything and kill as many people as they could and then go on. They weren't conquering in order to take the land. They were just conquering for the sake of conquer and whatever they could get. Well, they destroyed the irrigation systems that were throughout the Mesopotamian area, and most of them have never been rebuilt. So from the time of Genghis Khan and the Mongols on, it's gotten drier and drier and drier. There's still some fertile areas there, but most of them don't have, even if there's water in the rivers, it's not sufficiently distributed anymore like it once was to be able to do any good.
So theoretically, that area, Tigris, Euphrates, has the potential to be very lush. And
right. Yeah, I mean, I'm not an agronomist. I couldn't tell you it's possible the land is worn out or something, you know,
yeah.
Or erosion or whatever.
Yeah.
But that there was a time, even in you know, the Mongols being in fairly recent history by comparison to, you know, to ancient history, when it was a very fertile, you know, the whole thing. In fact, almost all of the domesticated crops that we have, you know, wheat, barley, and all those things were invented there. That's where they came from. They took wild grasses, crossed them, did all kinds of stuff, and that's where domesticated animals came from. You know, and 3,500 European cattle domesticated. That wasn't in Europe. That was in the Middle East, and then they later were taken into Europe. But they call them European cattle because that's the way we think of them. Because there's more cattle in Europe than there are there. You know, so the situation has very much changed over the millennia in that place. And we'll look at a picture, a map in just a second. Writing developed in Sumeria, again, pictographic writing. It looks like little drawings, similar to what modern Chinese and Japanese, for instance, is a kind of pictographic writing. I mean, they don't look like pictures we recognize, but that's what they're, you know, that's what they originally were. 3100, the first Egyptian pharaohs, dynasties began. So you're picking up that 1,000 years before the first of the pharaohs, or I mean 1,000 years after the first pharaohs was when Abraham comes along. 3000 BC was the Minoan Bronze Age on the island of Crete, the Minoan civilization, which we didn't even know about until the 1800s, but they've now discovered, you know, it was a very civilized culture, highly artistic, extraordinary. If you ever had a chance to go to Crete, to go to the palace at Gnosis and some of the others, they were very civilized, except they had this weird sport of bull vaulting. They have all these images of these young athletes, you know, dressed in like athletic gear, jumping over charging bulls. Sort of like your version, I guess, of, you know, bullfight, except they didn't hurt the bull, they just leapt over them.
More like rodeo, huh?
Sort of rodeo, yeah.
There had to be alcohol involved.
Actually, it's funny you say that. My oldest brother was a bull rider in rodeos. He placed fourth in the nation in Salinas, California. When he was young, a long time ago. But my other brother asked him one time, he said, you know, I understand most rodeo events, roping and, you know, throwing calves and tying, you know, and bronc riding and all that kind of stuff. He said, that all is stuff you do in ranch work. But he said, oh, where did bull riding come from? How did that come up with? And my oldest brother thought for a second, he said, you know, I think it had something to do with alcohol. So hold my beer and watch this.
Yes, yes. I didn't want to go there. But
yeah, exactly. And that was the same time that Athens began. It was around 3000. 2670 was the first Egyptian pyramid during the early dynasties. In 2475, maize is domesticated in Central America. I said most of the crops that we know. Now, corn came from the New World, but most of the other grain crops we know came from the Middle East, Mesopotamia. The first major empire in the around 2340, I didn't put circas on all this, but all this is all circa. The first major empire does come from Mesopotamia. It's under Sargon the Great. It was the Akkadian Empire, A-K-K-A-D-I-A-N. He was the first great conqueror, and because he conquered not only his city and the cities around his, because there were cities by that time, he then went out and conquered other areas, so that's why it's an empire. Around 2000 BC, Stonehenge is built in England. So this is after Abraham. Abraham was around before Stonehenge. And then around the 1800s BC is the rise of the Assyrian and Babylonian cultures, the Chaldean cultures as they're called. So that just gives you a context for what was happening in the world during this time. Okay? Questions? This is what that part of the world looked like then.
Then being
during the time of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? You've got the Persian Gulf. This is the Tigris River, and forking off from it here is the Euphrates River. Mesopotamia is this land between the rivers, which was fertile. You see this big green crescent here? That's called the Fertile Crescent, exactly because there was water, there was fertile land, and so the Fertile Crescent is one of the ways they refer to this part of the world. They also refer to this part of the world sometimes as the Levant, it's the connecting area between Asia, Africa, and Europe. You know, it was considered the center of the universe for that reason. You've got Babylonia, Sumer, which is the oldest, the Sumerian culture. You notice Ur right there, one of the believed to be perhaps the most ancient city. There's a lot of arguments about that, but it's certainly one of the early ones. And you will remember that Abraham was called from Ur of the Chaldees. That's there. And he went out first to Haran, which is where his father died, and then down here. I'll show you that route later. Susa was the capital of the Persian Empire later. So you get Persia, Media, you know, the Medes and Persians, Babylonia, Assyria, the Hurrians, the Hittites. This Fertile Crescent is the green. Canaan, this area here, Egypt, always been there. Now, if you look at it today, the red is the overlay of modern nations. So that you get Iraq, see Babylon, Babylonia, most of Mesopotamia is in modern Iraq. You get Iran as well over here in what used to be Persia. I've heard people say, you know, why does Iran and Iraq, why do they hate each other? They're all Arabs. They're not. Iranians are not Arabic. They're Persian. It's a completely different group. And then Turkey up here, and obviously it goes up further. Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Israel, West Bank, still Egypt, they're still there. Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Oman, Sudan, Ethiopia, Eritrea. So that's the overlay of the countries today, of the Middle East. United Arab Emirates, here's Dubai. Okay, questions? So you got a sense of where this all is. I'll show you some route maps from earlier. And again, you've got some really good maps and charts and stuff in that book that you've got, which will help you understand that as well. All right. Yes, Eddie.
I saw right before you this, it said right about where Ur is. It said
Garden of Eden.
But in the book, it
speculates
closer to Haran.
Okay.
Armenia at the top of the Armenian.
Right, which means we don't know. There's a more modern theory, interestingly, that you know, people have said, well, why, if this is the Holy Land, why is the Garden of Eden one of these places? Yeah. Since the God's focus seems to have been on Israel. You know, that's where he brought the people, brought them back to, etc. Well, there have been more recent, using satellite topography kinds of images, where they can actually see more than you can see with the naked eye. They've identified that there are major riverbeds, that in fact, this may have once been, the Jordan River may once have been tied into the Euphrates, and that the Tigris may have once come over here. And that it's possible that the rivers, you know, 4,000 plus years ago, or 6,000 plus years ago, may have been in a very different place. And they see some indication that one or both of those major rivers, the Tigris and Euphrates, may once have been over, you know, into or very close to what we think of as being the Holy Land. And that it may have been over there, because that may have been where the rivers were then. Rivers change a lot over centuries. So we don't know, okay? But
it's the exodus of Hebrew people, so to say.
Right? What was the question?
It somehow saved the... because all these Babylonians and Sumerians, anyway, they somehow vanished their culture.
Well, they haven't vanished. I mean, that's one of the things Saddam Hussein was trying to rebuild the ancient Babylon, because they see themselves as they are the descendants of the Babylonians. The Persians are the descendants of the Assyrians. You know, I mean, the Iranians, you know, are descendants of the Persian culture, which was the development from the Assyrian culture. So those cultures still exist, but not as, you know, as empires anymore. I remember once there was an episode of The Sopranos, you know, the organized crime thing, and there was this Jewish guy who was not wanting to give in to these Italian guys, and they were beating him up, and he said, you know, you can't defeat me. I'm a Jew, and we've conquered every place since. We even defeated the Roman Empire. Where are the Romans now? And these two Italian guys said, you're looking at them. Okay? Because they are descendants of that in the same way. Modern Iranians are descendants of Persia. Modern Iraqis are descendants of the Babylonians. So yeah, all of them are still around. The Egyptians are the only ones who still have the same name. And the Israelites. Well, the meaning, and when we get into the book of Exodus next week, we'll talk about that more. The Jews were in captivity in Egypt. You know, they were slaves. They had become enslaved. And so God called Moses up to go down and to lead them out of slavery, which he did through the arguments with Pharaoh. And once they had left Egypt, they ended up coming down here to the traditional location of Mount Sinai, where they received the law, is now on the Sinai Peninsula, which is right here. I mean, in fact, it's right about there. It's also the location today of St. Catherine's Monastery. Okay, Carol and I have been there a couple times. And so Mount Sinai is the mountain, traditionally, that sits there. It's really rocky. I mean, there's several mountains there. That looks right down over St. Catherine's Monastery. And so that's the traditional location. Now, there's a lot of belief that it may have actually been over here in Saudi Arabia, that they may have, that when they crossed the Red Sea, they didn't cross it here and get to Mount Sinai there, but rather they crossed it here and got to Mount Sinai somewhere over here. I actually lectured on the Exodus and the crossing of the Red Sea on the cruise ships. And a lot of people are beginning to think that when they crossed the Red Sea, what they actually crossed was the Gulf of Aqaba. This is the Gulf of Aqaba right here. Mm-hmm. And that they came this way and then crossed there so that they were actually in what we know of as Saudi Arabia when they went to the Mount Sinai. We don't know for sure. But the traditional location is in the Sinai Peninsula. Okay? Going to get into all sorts of other stuff. And the Exodus was not only to free the people, but so that God could show his faithfulness to them. And he could show his power. Because at that time, as I said, Egypt was the most powerful nation in the world. And God brought his people out of captivity there. So that later on, he would say, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of your fathers, the one who brought you up out of captivity in Egypt. That was the great claim of God's faithfulness and power to them from that point on. Okay? So, Genesis 1-11. Let's talk about the prehistoric prologue, or sometimes called the primeval history. The four events: creation, fall, flood, and Babel. First one, creation. You guys may even have this memorized, but in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is introduced in the second verse of the Bible. He's not a New Testament phenomenon. He didn't just decide to show up for the first time in Acts 2. It's also true when it says, verse 3, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. God spoke the word. It's called creation by fiat. He didn't have to do any work. He just had to say it. And so it's theologically legitimate to say that the word of God, the second person of the Trinity, was present as well, because it was through him. John says, it's through him all things were made, without him nothing was made that has been made. The Word of God, the Son of God. And so when God said, he spoke the Word, and the Word manifested the creation. Through him all things were made, without him nothing was made that has been made. Let there be light, and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and there was evening, and there was morning the first day. And of course it goes on, through 6 days of creation and a day of rest. Now, how do we understand that in terms of how did creation happen, when did it happen? There are six distinct theories. Two of them are sort of overlapping. But the one that the world usually accepts, the scientific explanation, is evolution by natural selection. Thank you, Charles Darwin. I have no problem with Darwin. I think he was mistaken about some things, but he was a good scientist. He paid attention, he observed some things. A lot of what we knew. Now, I'm not going to get into the whole argument about evolution. I don't think it holds water. I think there's a reason to distill the theory of evolution, because there are a lot of scientific facts that simply don't fit in the theory of evolution by natural selection. You know, that it all just, it happened over tens of millions of years, and it was all purely accidental, and etc. If you want to learn more about that, you can go back and watch the videos I've done on apologetics, or else keep taking classes until I get back to those. We talk about that a lot there. So that's one. The second option is theistic evolution, which means evolution occurred over the last X billion years, but that all of it was directed by God. That every time, you know, there was a crossing of DNA materials between two creatures, it was God that decided, this is the characteristic I want to have develop, etc. That he was the one who was directing the process all along the way. So people who believe in theistic evolution believe that God did it, but he did it through the evolutionary process. Okay? Make sense? The third option is called the day-age view. And that is that while the Genesis account has day one, day two, day three, the day-age view is that every one of those days is not one 24-hour day. For instance, the sun wasn't created until the fourth day, so how do you have days? So the idea is that each one of those days represents a long period of time in which these things were developed. There are scriptures like, to the Lord, one day is as 10,000 years and 10,000 years a day, that indicate to us that God doesn't follow the same chronological rules that we do. And so each of those days may represent a much longer period of time than what we think of as a day. That's the day-age view. The fourth is the ruin reconstruction view, sometimes called the gap theory. Between verse 1 and verse 2, it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. The Spirit of God was hovering. And then in between those, it's believed by some people that there was this massive period of time that God created, but it was all still a ruin. And so, and we had millions of years when everything was just sort of cooking. And then God starts what we think of as the creative, you know, the organizing process. So the gap theory says there's a huge gap between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2. And that accounts for the long age attributed to things. All right?
Where does that come from? I mean, did somebody just decide that that's the way it will be?
Well, the fact that... it comes from an effort to try to explain what appears to be the evidence in front of us. And so, yeah, it's creative. I mean, it's somebody came up with it. But they came up with it as a way to try to explain how, you know, science consistently says things are much, much older than 6,000, 7,000 years old. And yet, how, in other words, to try to answer two questions. How can we believe that this is the true story of creation? And how can we accept what all of science says is the nature of the created universe? How do those two things fit together? These are creative efforts to try to answer those two questions, both of them in the affirmative. Okay? That make sense? So yeah, there's no evidence for it. They didn't find an extra book somewhere. They said, oh, well, this explains it. There's an effort to try to take all of the data available to us, both scriptural and scientific, and say, how might this work together? All right? What's that?
Because God didn't tell us.
Because he didn't tell us. He doesn't have the details. The fifth version is creationism. Creationism is the belief that God did create the world in 6 literal days. Basically 6 24-hour days. And that we should read the account of Genesis quite literally. Now, a subset of that is called the literal day view or the young earth view. These are the folks, and this is a subset really of creationism. Some people might even say these are the same thing because most people who follow who would advocate creationism would also advocate the literal day view. Then that would say the whole world was created in 6 24-hour days as we understand them, and that it only happened 6,000 to 10,000 years ago. All right? These are the most conservative, creationism and the young earth creationism, which as I say is probably considered a subset. So you're going here from completely secular to really ultra-conservative Christian interpretations. And, yes, Joanne?
How can they discount science? I mean, they're totally discounting science.
Yes. They come up with alternate explanations for it. Some of the explanations I don't think make sense. You know, I've had people tell me, when you say, well, what about the dinosaur bones? You know, where'd the dinosaurs go? And the explanation that they will often give for that is, well, God put those bones there to test our faith. I don't think God works like that. And I think there are other ways of doing that. I'm not trying to parody that. I'm not trying to make fun of that. I mean, I know people of good faith that maintain that. I don't think we have to do that. I don't think we have to believe that God is the creator God. I don't think we have to go through all those gyrations. My own view would be somewhere along the line of day age. I probably fall somewhere in there. Believing that scripture means it when it says to God a day is as 10,000 years and 10,000 years a day, I don't think we have to interpret you know, and on the first day, God said, let there be light, as being a 24-hour day. Like I said, that's according to that account, the sun didn't even exist then. So we don't have to interpret yom, which is the Hebrew word, as just being day. It can also mean a longer period of time. The real crux, the point is, did God do it? And I think the unequivocal answer for us there is yes, God did it. However he chose to do it, we simply don't know exactly how. And different people have different theories. I don't accept number one. I don't think it's just evolution by natural selection. I don't think this is, for one thing, the requirements for evolution by natural selection is that every evolutionary benefit, or every evolutionary development has to, by definition in natural selection, has to demonstrate a positive benefit that contributes to survival. Well, there is, you know, they talk about irreducible complexity, which means that if you take some of the complex aspects of animal life, let's say human life, for instance, the highest form, there's no intermediate stage between being a one-celled organism and being what we are that would explain, in terms of advances in survival capability. For instance, like the human eye, a strict evolutionist would say that the human eye began as a light, sensitive freckle. Well, the number of stages of development, I'm not making that up. The number of stages that a light, sensitive freckle would have to go through to develop the complexity of the human eye, with rods and cones that can sense color and the ability to, you know, to work together to create three dimensions, and you know, the optic nerve feeding messages from the retina that the brain can interpret as being, and all of that, there are not intermediate steps in that process from a light sensitive freckle to the human eye that would offer advantages in survival. It has to, the only explanation is the eye, as we know it, had to come out fully blown. And the only way to do that is if somebody created it, if some being created it. Because there's no way to back up from that to a light sensitive freckle. Make sense?
Yeah.
So that's why I don't think it works. Yes?
Number two of your theistic evolution, isn't that, and I understand you correctly, that's really number one, except you have to say directed by God, controlled by God, whatever.
Right.
Okay. And so are there any of these that a person of faith cannot say, I subscribe to this personally, but it's all under God's control in his bailiwick?
Right. Well, number one is an answer that has no belief in God, inherently denies a belief in God.
Because the theism part of number two is denied.
Exactly.
By number one.
Number two is number one with God in it.
Okay, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if you said I'm a person of faith and I believe in evolution, then you are number two. Because by definition,
yes.
by definition, number one, there was no God. That's the natural part. That it is purely an accident, that there was no intentionality behind it, which is we believe there was intentionality behind the creation. So the very least you could do if you have a belief in God is to say number two. To me, it still feels like there's a lot of potential for accidental stuff going on. I mean, that still, each of the evolutionary kind of progression things, it makes much more sense to me to have an order. It still seems random, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Number three makes more sense to me, that God was very intentional, but he just took a longer time to do each of these things than one day. You could say that's an evolutionary theory as well, and to some extent it is. I believe the world probably is 4.5 billion years old, for instance. But it was made by God, and he has never been out of control. He's never, you know, he didn't take an extended vacation, and we don't know where he is or how to get hold of him.
The seventh day.
What's that?
The seventh day was an extended vacation.
Exactly, 7 days was a vacation. But, so that's why I would say I'm more in the day-age kind of view. It seems to me that the gap theory is sort of where you were. Well, where did that come from? How's that? I don't think you need that in order to explain it. And that seems like a pretty big creative jump. So first, Julia, and then Marvin.
Well, I don't see how theistic evolution can solve the irreducible complexity question.
Right. it would have to remove, it doesn't, it's not true, literally true to scientific evolution, because it would say, for instance, if God went from a life, a light-sensitive freckle to an eye, and he allowed it to evolve, it's because God said, okay, the next stage I'm going to do is this, and then I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do that, and now I have an eye.
But that's not natural selection either.
Mm-hmm. Well, it is. Well, natural selection says those things happen in stages, but they happen by accident.
But they didn't benefit the organism until
right.
They were entirely...
That's why I say theistic evolution is not actually accurate to evolution, because it's saying there were things that were happening by God's intention that were not consistent with evolutionary theory. Okay? Marvin?
On day two, how old did Adam look? Or on day two, how old did the tree look? You know, a river valley has got striations of soil and mountains have...
Well, they didn't come till day 5 and 6.
Well, what I'm getting at is it was a mature Adam that he created. Yeah. It was mature trees.
Right.
A lot of the earth, all the deposits of coal and oil and natural gas in the ground, under the oceans, for goodness sakes, you know, it was either created mature or it
right.
took a long time.
Right.
You know, we don't have to say which.
Exactly, and that's the argument people make about the dinosaur bones, and they would say, in the same way that you know Adam was made as a mature man, he wasn't made as a baby. They would say, so it's possible that God created the earth as a mature earth, which means it includes fossils and things like that. But again, my question then is, but why would he do that? What's the upside? And they say, well, it's to test our faith. That's not the way God tests our faith. We have no other examples where God gives us fake evidence and expects us to figure out how to discount it. That's not the way he does that.
That's like a faith trick.
Exactly. It's like a trick. Okay. Julia?
Well, if creationism or literal faith would say that the flood changed everything so much that probably the dinosaurs couldn't live after... You know, in the atmospheric conditions and so forth. I mean, they would have been on an ark, but they probably didn't proliferate very
right.
much.
But then, you know, then the scientists would say, then why do we find no evidence of any human existence anywhere close to the age that is indicated by the dinosaur bones? It's not like they found dinosaur bones and human bones together.
They haven't been to Glen Rose, Texas.
Okay. Well, some of the creation. Yeah.
Well, I walked in the tracks there, and there were people's tracks that we could discern. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the dinosaur tracks could have been there for millennia before the people then walked over the same area. But anyway, we're a little past taking a break. It's the library, Jane.
Yeah, I know this is a stupid question.
No, there's no stupid questions.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there are.
Where are the planets in all of this?
Well, the planets.
Yeah.
In the creation, when God created, in fact, let me do this, because we'll get into that. I'm just going to stick all this up here. These are the 7 days of creation. First, God said, and let there be light, and there was light. Day two, he separated the waters above from the waters below, so waters and dry land. Third, he separated the water above and the water below. And then third, he created dry land and vegetation. Day four, he created the sun, the moon, and the stars, the sources of light. Greater light to rule the day and a lesser light to rule the night. So that's why the whole thing about having days is kind of funny as we understand it, because it wasn't until day four that he created the sun. And the day is defined as a revolution of the earth in front of the sun. Then day five, fish and birds to fill the water and sky. And then day six, the rest of land animals, and finally man. And then day seven, the seventh rest. So you asked the question about when did he create the planets? Well, day four was when he created, according to this, the sun, the moon, the stars. So that would seem the likely time. However, if you know, the Big Bang Theory, which is not all scientists, but most scientists would maintain, I don't mean the TV show, but that's a really funny TV show. but the Big Bang Theory, that there was this infinitely dense particle of matter that exploded, and as it exploded outward, and the materials from that explosion eventually began to sort of gather together, and they formed the planets and the galaxies, etc. Well, the description that there was this massive explosion, and they describe it as, you know, as this the brightest light ever, you know, kind of thing. Sound like a pretty good description of what it might be like if the God who ruled all the universe said, "Let there be light," and there was an explosion of light. I think that those things very likely could fit, you know, are describing the same thing. Well, if that's the case, then you could say that the explosion, you know, outward, that, assuming you don't think these were four literal days, that coalescing of some of the materials from the Big Bang into planets and galaxies and stuff, it may have been that what happened on day one, by day four, was when they started forming the various stars and planets and galaxies and other things. So that the scientific explanation and this could very well be exactly the same thing. In fact, I think it is.
Mm-hmm. What was that?
You said about black and unknown masses, so what we discovered recently.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
It was unclear mass, I guess somebody got Nobel Prize for that.
Okay.
Unclear mass, like not, I don't know.
Well, there's some scientists that say they don't really believe the Big Bang as it's historically been told, and we don't know, you know. Yeah, but to me, I think that if we recognize the Big Bang as the start, that God did it, and see that's one of the problems with the theory of creation by random event, by, you know, life. Natural selection refers to life, but if you ask somebody how did the universe come to be created and they're not a person of faith, they will say, well, there was this infinitely dense particle of matter. Infinitely dense. In other words, it contained sufficient materials to populate the universe with planets and stars and stuff.
But where did that come from?
And it exploded, exactly. And you go, it exploded, and you go, well, but where did that infinitely dense particle of matter come from? There is no answer to that.
No.
There's always a, and then what caused it to explode?
Yeah,
and there's one school of, or one discipline of apologetics, which looks at it's called scientific apologetics, which looks at all of the scientific evidence that had to be exactly right. For instance, if the force of gravity, you know, there are four natural forces in the world. If the force of gravity had been greater or lesser by 10 to the 40th power, 10 to 40 zeros after it. If it had been greater or lesser, if it had been lesser by 10 to the 40th power, then the Great Big Bang would have collapsed back in on itself. It would have it's blown itself out because it would have been moving too fast. If it had been any greater, you know, by 10 to the 40th power, greater, you know, tiny amount, then it would have caved back in on itself. In other words, the exact, and that's just one of them, there are like over 200 that science has discovered that creation only could have occurred if it was precisely what it was. The slightest variation, plus or minus, it could not have happened. Yes?
I see how you have this laid out, and maybe you've already explained this while I'm outside of the room, but it's like poetry, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's Hebrew poetry, and if we don't take those one, two, three as chronology,
right.
Like, then that whole thing about, well, the sun wasn't even created until day four is, you know, the light, the sun, they do go with each other.
Right.
The water in the sky, the fish in the woods,
right.
The dry land, the land. It's poetry.
It is,
it's
and I want to show you some other examples. This is called Hebrew parallelism.
Yeah.
That they write, that they were, you know, they didn't just put stuff down. They had a very intentional structure that they did things by. And let me give you, and Carolyn's exactly right, this is reflected in that, the 6 days of creation. It's a parallel, you know, 1 to 3 parallels, 4 to 6, and then God rested. Let me give you another example. I'm just going to put all this up here. We have chapters 1 to 3, creation is completed, the heaven and earth, verses 1 to 3, God finishes his work, man is created, he's formed from the dust of the earth, then the trees and rivers in the garden are given names, man is assigned the task of guarding and keeping the garden. And then there's the story of the forbidden fruit. All the fruit of the garden you may eat except for this one. Then it goes backward in terms of the meaning. You know, it's like it rises up and then it comes back down again. And there are parallels all the way along. After the forbidden fruit, we say man is in need of a helper. It's not good for him to be alone. He'd been told to take care of the garden. He needed somebody to help, if you look above that. Then animals in the garden are given names. Earlier, the trees and rivers in the garden have been given names. Then woman is created as a parallel to the point at which man was created. And then creation is complete. Men and women are naked and unashamed of the presence of God. And so there is this, this is Hebrew parallel literature. And it happens throughout all of Scripture. We'll look at a little bit of that later on if I hurry up. Now, one of the things that people will claim is that, that liberal, you know, people, non-believing people will say, is that, well, Genesis has two completely different creation stories. There's Genesis 1 and there's Genesis 2, and they're different. How can there be two stories of creation? Well, that's not accurate, because if you read them, they're very different, and, in fact, Genesis 1 is the story of the heavens and the earth created in 6 days. Genesis 2 is the creation of man and woman, with no element of time mentioned. Now, what happened? In other words, there's the big creation story in chapter 1. In chapter 2, it focuses in on just the creation of humanity, which is the part we're most interested in, and is the high point of the creation. Joanne?
Is the camera on?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
thank you for being concerned. Then, the man in his cosmic setting, man is central to God's purpose. See, it's all of these are focusing in. The panorama of creation as a whole and the detail focus on one aspect of creation, that is humanity. Centers on God's creating the heavens and the earth, and then centers on man's crowning act of God's creation. So it's like you lay out the, you know, the big, it's like in this class, I'm giving you a survey, we're going to look at everything. Well, then if after this you really need to know more information about the book of Exodus, then you take a class just on Exodus. It's not that that's contrary to the survey class. It's a focusing in on the part that was really important to you. Okay, that's what Genesis 1 and Genesis 2 are about.
Yeah, but about the man, it's always overestimating our importance, I guess.
Well, we are made in the image of God. We are the highest point of all creation. And we need to feel good about that part. And then we're going to get to the part right now that we ought to feel bad about, which is the fall. See, we were made in God's image and made to be a special creature with whom he could be in a relationship with. That's why we're made in God's image, so that we can relate to him in a way that none of the rest of creation can. But then we messed up, okay? Which is the story of the fall. This is the second great event in the primeval history, primeval prologue or prehistoric prologue. Genesis 3. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild... this is not continuous. I've taken verses in order to give the whole story in one slide. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? So one of the devil's tricks is to ask us, are you sure you got that right? And then verse 6, when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they saw that they were naked, and they made coverings out of leaves to cover themselves. And then the extraordinary story, the Lord God was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and he calls out to them, where are you? And they finally realize he's going to eventually find them, so they come out of hiding, and he sees that they've covered themselves and said, who told you you were naked? So this is the story of the fall, and it tells us basically what's wrong with us. There has never been a culture anytime anywhere in history that we know anything about that did not have a basic sense that there's something wrong with us, that we are broken in some way. This explains it. So the first part of the prehistoric prologue, creation, tells us where everything came from, how it came to be. Second focuses on us, the fall, and says, here's what's wrong with us. Here's why we all have a sense that we're not everything we should be. We all have an itch that feels like it needs to be scratched. And that itch is to be in relationship with God, not to be separated from him by our own betrayal of him. So this is critically important stuff, right?
Yeah, but this is such a beautiful expression of the era before the sin.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, this is the start of sin. Yeah, I mean, the part of it beforehand. But then when Eve takes the apple and eats it, she knows she's disobeying God. She is actually told, the part of the era I had to cut in order to get on one slide, she says, oh no, God told us we can't do that. You know, she knows, but she does it anyway. Because she thinks, good for food, pleasing to the eye, and desirable for gaining wisdom. And then she gives it to her husband. And so when God says, who told you that you were naked, Adam does what men have been doing ever since, and blames the woman. Well, and he actually blames God, too. He says, it's this woman you gave me, she's the one that got me, and it's the woman you gave me, you know, so it's your fault and it's her fault. Don't blame me, all right?
That's a little bit funny, but I don't have a doubt in my mind that that tone of voice and that attitude is exactly what he was saying.
I think so.
This is all me.
Hey, well, you gave her to me, and she's the one that did this. Don't blame me. And he sort of overlooks the fact that, duh, I could have made my own decision here, you know.
He could have chosen one of the animals.
Yeah.
When they were writing before him to name
them. Right, to name them. Okay, so this is the fall. This then is the progression. Adam and Eve, they have first two sons, Cain and Abel, that we hear about. Cain commits the first murder in history because God is more inclined to the gift that Abel presents to the Lord than he is Cain's, and Cain kills him out of jealousy. And so the first murder. Adam and Eve have another son, Seth. And then the descendants from those, from Cain, there are three generations down to Lamech. Lamech is the second person to commit murder. He kills someone who offends him. He's also the first polygamist. He has two wives. Everybody before that was married to one person. So the original plan wasn't polygamy. That came later. And then from Seth, there are eight generations down to Noah, which is where we get to the next story, which is the next major point of the prehistoric prologue, which is the flood. And then Noah's three sons, Ham, Japheth, and Shem. We'll return to that later. Shem is the father of the Semitic peoples. Now, I never have quite figured out why they changed the words so much. You know, how did Philistine become Palestine? How did Shem become Semite? You know, they just, let's get rid of some consonants in there. But that's, so this is the case. And by the way, and I'll just throw this in, I don't want to get into a long conversation about this, but there are references in the Pentateuch to the sons of God marrying the daughters of men, and the Nephilim, and all this scary, weird stuff that people have all kinds of crazy ideas about. Probably the most sensible theory I've ever heard about that is not that angels came down to earth and all of that, but rather that these two lines, the line of Seth that led to Noah, who was a righteous man, and then his sons, and the line of Cain, after Cain was a murderer, and three generations later, you know, the fourth generation after Cain, is another murderer who marries two women, which was not the way it was to be done, that the children of Seth represented the children of God because they sought God. They were consistent. And down to Noah, who was a righteous man in God's eyes. That's why he was the one he chose to have the ark. Versus the descendants of Cain, who are the daughters of men, those who really had walked away from God, as demonstrated by Lamech murdering somebody else. Okay, that there was intermarriage between those. Or it could be that, you know, these people intermarried with Neanderthals. I don't know. We all have some Neanderthal blood in us. I'm 4%. I am, for a fact. I had my genetic stuff tested, and I'm 4%. Now, Carolyn thought that was funny until I told her that the average Anglo, you know, like the average North American, is more than 6% to the end of it all. So I'm actually less than usual. Go ahead.
So, this is always been a little gray area. So when Cain murdered and was,
cast out,
who did he marry?
Well, yeah, the suggestion was, they don't talk about the daughters very much, but it's very possible he could have married his sisters. And geneticists would say that if this really happened, today, if you marry your sister, there's all sorts of genetic problems. I mean, one of the reasons that a lot of the royalty in Europe ended up being duh, is because they were marrying close relatives, and they did that over and over again, right? But back then, the genetics would have been much purer, and they would not have had, the more you do that, the more you interbreed, and this is true with dogs or horses or anything else, then the more genetic problems you run into. But it had never been done before that, so the likelihood that there being a negative consequence back then, minimal.
So Adam and Eve have a lot of children.
Perhaps so.
Don't speak of it.
Or it may be that, you know, this is where it started, but that God provided other, you know, other wives or husbands for the descendants as they came along. Could be either one. Okay? Mm-hmm. We don't, and, you know, a lot of the stuff we simply don't know. We're not told. And we can make all kinds of stuff up, you know. MSU, as Carolyn and I sometimes call it, making stuff up. You know. But this is the generations. And Noah I mention here because the third great event is the flood. Genesis 6. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. Again, Lamech being an example of that, murdering, you know, polygamous, etc. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. So make yourself an ark of cypress wood, make rooms in it, and coat it with pitch inside and out. This is, and we did that in the church, in the foundation. You know, we use this tar stuff, which is basically pitch, to insulate against water, right? This is how you're to build it. The ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Make a roof for it, leaving below the roof an opening 1 cubit high all around. Put a floor on the side of the ark and make lower, middle, and upper decks. I'm going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens, every creature that has the breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. You are to bring into the ark 2 of all living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you. So the most important question to be answered here is, what's a cubit? Old joke. A cubit is about 18 inches. Cubit is the most ancient, the Egyptian cubit is the most ancient measurement we're aware of. And cubit, there's two interpretations of it, is it means elbow, because a cubit was the distance from the tip of your longest finger to your elbow. And then that various cultures used it, the Sumerians used it, the Egyptians used it, and in the Bible, this distance had been established at basically 18 inches. So it's a foot and a half. So when we say that the boat is to be 300 cubits long, that's 450 feet. Okay, football field and a half. That's big. Okay. Well, you're going to put two of every kind of animal on it. And people say, how did that work? Well, all dogs are genetically related. And the possibility that over the millennia since then, they all have developed from original dogs. They have the same basic genetic makeup, whether they're a dachshund or a Great Dane. And so it appears to be that's part of the plan. You didn't take one variety, you know, one of each kind of variety of every type of animal. And so there could be descent from that. So this, the flood, and of course, I'll give you, you'll notice Mount Ararat, which is where scripture said that the boat landed. There, the belief by many is that it's in Turkey. Some have claimed that they have found what appears to be the remnants of the ark in Iran, in the mountains in Iran. There are many different theories about it. A number of different people over the centuries, especially in the last century, have claimed to have found it. But the areas that it's located are restricted. Not just anybody's allowed to go there. You know, it's very difficult to get permission. You're not allowed to bring anything back other than photographic evidence. And of course, it doesn't look like a boat anymore. So, but that's the traditional location. Just like this is the traditional location of Mount Sinai, a lot of people say it's over here. This is the traditional location of Mount Ararat. But some people say that it's over in here, right? So we don't know. One of the most popular topics of art and storytelling and, you know, possible. Artists down through the centuries have particularly, you know, the parade of animals as the sky darkens, the parade of animals two by two, you know, entering into the ark. And of course, there have been a number of attempts, there's even a more recent one than this, to rebuild according to the original description of what the ark looked like. And this one is in the Netherlands. There's a new one in the U.S. that's just opened, a new flood history park. It's a whole theme park kind of thing. But this one was in the Netherlands. It's from a number of years ago. Now, Let me.
From Norway, Netherlands.
What's that?
I imagine that there is something in Norway similar, but it's the office, the limitation. Is it a real ship?
Well, it doesn't float. It's dry docked, but it's made so that it apparently could float. They tried to be as authentic as they could. Yeah, there are a number of them around the world. Now, this is a photo that was taken in Mount Ararat. The people who had investigated this claimed that they found petrified wood. This is at 14,000 feet of Mount Ararat, so it's very high elevation. But this, they said, represents, it's about over 400 feet long. They say that they took samples here, and just small core samples, because they couldn't bring a lot out. And then when they had it tested, it's petrified wood, and it has sea creatures in it, you know, like krill and stuff like that. So how did the sea creatures get to 14,000 feet? Again, some people say this might be it. Some people say it might be elsewhere. Some people say this was a metaphor, that, you know, God intended to teach a lesson through it, but maybe it didn't really happen. I am inclined to think it really did happen, but I don't need to know that. You know, my faith is not dependent upon that. I actually had a friend of mine, there's a client actually that I got to be friends with. He was involved in James Irwin, who was one of the astronauts. He's very involved in the search for the Ark. They sometimes refer to this as archaeology. A-R-K-E-O-L-O-G-Y. But the search for Noah's Ark is a major theme. You know, there have been lots of documentaries done and everything else. James Irwin was very involved, and this guy who worked for a ministry that I was doing consulting for, he had been involved in all that. And I asked him one day, I said, why, you know, obviously you're very passionate about this. And I said, it's really cool, it's really interesting, but why so much passion? And he said, because if we can prove that this is Noah's Ark, then millions of people will come to faith in Jesus. And I went, no, they won't. I wish they would, but Jesus said, even if someone rises up from the dead, people won't believe. If you find an ancient boat, you're going to find all sorts of reasons not to believe it, and it's not going to, you know, you might get one or two if you're lucky, but people just aren't going to go there.
If you prove it, where's the faith?
Exactly. So once again, we talked about the way in which the Pentateuch is written, especially the book of Genesis. It starts out talking about Noah's three sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. The covenant that God made with Noah, and he said, you're my people, you know, I'm selecting you, but I'm going to destroy all the rest of the earth with a flood. He commands them to gather up food, and the animals. He takes them, tells them, go on the ark 7 days before the rain starts. Then the rain starts and there's flood on the earth. And then, you know, we've got the 40 days of rain and then 40 days of the receding of the water. And, you know, Noah's sending out birds to see. And when they bring back a branch, he knows that it's getting better. And then finally when the birds don't come back, he says, okay, we're fine. Then Noah and his family come out of the ark. This is a parallel to them going into the ark. Then there's the command as to what you can and can't eat, which is related to the command to take food with them. Then there is the new covenant with Noah, which is called the Noahic covenant, the promise not to destroy the earth with a flood after saying he was going to. He says, I'm not going to do it again, and he gives the rainbow as a symbol of the promise. And then Noah's three sons. You know, it's funny, I've had people look at our logo, which has the sort of rainbow-colored circle on it. And because that's become a symbol for the gay and lesbian movement, they say, so are you a gay church? I go, the rainbow was given to Noah by God. Yeah. Just because you have a rainbow doesn't mean that that it's some social commentary. So God gave the rainbow, and then there's a reference to Noah's three sons and their interaction with Noah when he gets drunk and all that kind of stuff. So again, you get this parallelism. If you dig into it a little bit deeper, the flood on the earth being the center point of that. I'm going to just put all this up here again so you can see it. The microcosm in chapter 7 and 8, the Lord shuts the doors and it rains 40 days a night. The water increases until the mountains are covered. 150 days the waters prevail. God remembers Noah and his people. It's not like he forgot, but it's just, it basically means he got to the point that he said, okay, now's the time. You know, and he makes his presence known. And then for 150 days, the waters abate. I said 40 a minute ago, sorry, 150. The waters decrease until the mountains become visible, and at the end of the 40 days, after they've abated, Noah opens the window. Okay? So you get this Hebrew parallelism. The fourth great event in the prehistoric prologue is, in some ways the most mysterious of all of them, is the Tower of Babel from Genesis 11. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the whole earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and tower that they were building. The Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand each other. So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it's called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole earth. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. To Babel, you know, meaningless noises. That's where we get that. So this is the confusion of the languages, the story of the Tower of Babel. It is believed it likely was in Babylon. So question mark, we don't know for sure, but that's likely where it was, because this was one of the most sophisticated cultures at that time. Again, like Noah's Ark, this has been the object of an extraordinary amount of artistic representation and expression. Here's a painting by one of the European masters on the building of the Tower of Babel. It almost looks like the decay of the Tower of Babel, but it's the process of being built. Now, lest we think that this is, you know, sort of nuts, this is a Middle Eastern ziggurat, it's called. It's a stepped pyramid. Before the Egyptians invented the straight-sided pyramids, this was the way that they were building buildings. And we have a number of different examples of it. In fact, this is an artistic representation of the Great Pyramid of Ur. You know, Ur of the Chaldees, south in the Mesopotamia from where we were looking at. And this is actually it. They dug it out.
Wow.
And I put this here, you can see the airplane, but this is actually 6,000 years old.
It's almost like Bauhaus.
Mm-hmm. Bauhaus, okay. And I think, do I have another? No, I don't. You can go online and look up the Great Pyramid of Ur. They dug it out. It, because it was covered in sand, it was very well preserved. They have other of these ziggurats that are in existence. They were religious sites. They would have religious services on top of them. They also were used for protection of the priests, because there's only like three stairways to get up to it. So didn't take many men to guard it if they wanted to. If they're having religious ceremonies, nobody else was supposed to see. But this really exists. And so we have examples of these kind of extraordinary buildings that they were building back long, long time ago. Okay? This was end of the third millennium, end of the fourth millennium, start of the third millennium BC. So it was 6,000, right at 6,000 years ago that this was built.
Was Saddam Hussein involved in uncovering?
No, I think it had been uncovered before him. It's been there for a while. Okay. So, and there have been obviously a lot of research done around it. But then there are other ziggurats as well, you know, that they found. So
it's huge.
It is huge. I mean, there's an airplane taking off behind it. But there's also, I saw some video of, during the Iraq War, of some U.S. soldiers walking up these steps, once they had entered that part of the country. Okay? So, these four great events in the prehistoric prologue are critical to understanding the nature of humanity. This is an example of why the Old Testament is so important to us, why we can't just set it aside. It tells us where we came from, what is wrong with us, why, that God is a righteous God and He will judge against evil, and that there's a reason why we have trouble communicating with each other, basically. You know, why are there so many languages? You know, what sense does that make? How did we get there? Well, this is an explanation. We then get to the second section of, well, I didn't even realize I had this one in here still. So from Noah we have Ham, Japheth, and Shem. Ham becomes the predecessor to the people of Canaan, who were the people who lived in the area we know as Palestine or Israel or the Holy Land, that originally resided there. And then from Shem, there are 8 generations. He was the ancestor of Abraham, which is why Abraham was Semitic, a descendant of Shem. Then Abraham's son Isaac had 2 children. Isaac had Jacob and Esau. Esau became the father of the Edomites. Abraham's other child, other than Isaac, was Ishmael. Ishmael became the father of the Arabic peoples. The Arabic peoples are Semitic people, just like the Jews are. They are from the same descent. Arabic is closely related to Hebrew, Aramaic, a number of other languages from that part of the world are Semitic languages. It's a whole family of languages because it's the people who were descended from Shem, right? Okay? Now, the second part of the book of Genesis, chapters 12 to 50, is where instead of the 4 major events, we have people predominating, and especially 4 people, the 4 primary patriarchs. Now, some lists of patriarchs, they list 10, and they'll include others. But primarily, the Jewish people think in terms of 4 major patriarchs: Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. And those 4 people are the primary focus, along with, you know, secondary characters like Sarah and the other sons of Jacob and Esau and others in this section. Now, this is a larger lineage from Abraham. And the red, by the way, are those that were involved in the lineage of Jesus. Okay, this is a chart that I got from online. Terah was the father of Abram, who half-sister Sarah, they married Sarai. See, that was common back then. He married his half-sister Sarai, who later became Abraham and Sarah. They had a son, Isaac, but not until Abram, because they got tired of waiting, and Sarai actually came up with the idea. And they discovered other evidence that this was fairly common back then. Sarai's handmaiden was named Hagar. Sarai says, "Why don't you, Abram, take my handmaiden Hagar and have a child by her? And then that'll become our heir, etc." That apparently was not unusual in those days. So they have Ishmael. Then later, Sarai has Isaac, and if she just waited, God had promised she was going to have a child. And Ishmael is sent off because Sarai doesn't want him around, because since he's older, he might try to claim the right of succession from Abram. So they send him off, and there's where, because he's the father of the Arabic people, there's where the Quran emphasizes Abraham and Ishmael. For instance, according to the Quran, the Islamic belief, it was Ishmael that Abraham almost sacrificed, not Isaac. So they put Ishmael in that role. Then Isaac has 2 sons, Esau and Jacob. Esau became the father of Edom, which was another nation there that ended up being judged by God. And then Jacob has 4 wives, Rachel, whom he loved but didn't get first. Lots of stories there. Leah, Bilhah, and Zilpah. He has 12 children. Judah, who was ended up being the largest of the tribes, each of these sons, 12 sons, became father of tribes, so that there were 12 tribes of Israel, because Jacob's name gets changed to Israel. We'll look at that in the next 9 minutes. Judah became the largest tribe, and it was through the line of Judah that Jesus was born. That's why it's red on this chart. But Joseph is actually the 4th patriarch, because he's the one that God especially used to fulfill his will in the Old Testament times. All right? So now you see how everybody's related, you know. So the call and covenant with Abraham. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you," and then he promises, "I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And so peoples on earth will be blessed through you." All peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you, and will greatly increase your numbers." He was 99 when he got the promise. And it was quite a few years before he actually had Isaac, the son of the promise. Abram fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations," which is why he changed his name. No longer will you be called Abram, your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations, and will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. And then later on, he restates his covenant, and he includes the promise for a land in which they will live, the promised land. Okay? Once again, we get the Hebrew parallelism. Okay? We start out with Abram being called to faith and the promise that he will be a father of great people. There's a sojourn in Egypt where he goes down to Egypt with Sarai and lies about her and says that she's, because he's afraid that he'll get killed if the Pharaoh wants to take his wife. So he lies and says that she's his sister. They straighten all that out. And then Lot, who was the nephew of Abram, separates because they've got both got such big herds, they have to go different directions to make use of the land. There was a war against Sodom, and there's the rescue of Lot by Abram. He goes down to save him in Sodom before the city's destroyed. There is a covenant ceremony, an animal sacrifice, and then Ishmael is born. Then we go backwards. A covenant sign is to be circumcision, not just animal sacrifice, but circumcision. Then the destruction, eventually, of Sodom and the rescue of Lot by angels. The sojourn in Gerar, and once again, the denial, this time, of Sarah, because her name has changed. But there's a parallel there. And then Ishmael separates from Abram, as Lot had separated from Abram earlier, and Abraham's faith is tested in terms of the sacrifice of Isaac. So you see the parallelism. These are the great stories. This is the root from Ur. He was in Ur of the Chaldees. The Chaldees was that area, and Chaldean, the language that the Babylonians spoke and a version of the Assyrians spoke, is what we call Aramaic. That's why after the Hebrew people, when the Babylonians destroyed the southern kingdom of Judah and the temple in Jerusalem in 586 BC, and the people were taken off into captivity in Babylon for over 50 years, the children learned Aramaic, Chaldean. And that's why Jesus and everybody at that point spoke Aramaic, as well as Hebrew, as well as Greek. So, Abram, and then Abraham from here up to Haran, and then down through Aram to Canaan. He is called by God. All right? Yes?
Sorry. Can you go back about three slides to the scripture? Okay, in 17, 1 and 2, okay, God says, walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you. But this was, if I understand correctly, this was not a conditional covenant. I mean, it's not, if you do this, then I'll do this.
That's correct. God was making the offer, but it wasn't conditional in terms of you got to agree to that up front. But it was the case, and this is always true, and the Israelites were a chosen people. And God had just said, I'm putting my mark on you. But then when they violated his trust in the covenant agreement, then he would judge them. You know, they would suffer, but then he would call them back. Uh-huh. So it's not conditional, but it is, it's an unconditional agreement, but with the understanding that you are going to be, you're going to follow through on this.
Yeah.
So that's not necessary in order for the covenant to be enforced, because it can't be done away with. But it is part of the agreement.
Yeah, it's not dependent upon them, it's dependent upon God.
Exactly. Yep.
Does that mean that God's not going to throw him away, no matter what?
Right. And he hasn't.
And he hasn't. Right.
No. The promise was, you're going to be my people and I will be your God. That's never changed. Right. He's opened it up because he had promised since the very first commitment to Abraham that I will bless all peoples through you. And then this is, you get some of the idea of the back and forth, back and forth. Think about going that far on foot, you know, all the way down to Egypt and then back up to Haran and then, you know, back again. Abram's journeys, and then the blue line, dotted line, is the campaign of the Eastern Kings against some of these areas. I was preaching a Christmas sermon last year or the year before, and there's a couple in our church that don't hear very well. And so whenever they talk to each other in the service, I can hear exactly what they're saying when I'm in the pulpit. And I mentioned how far Mary and Joseph with the baby Jesus had to walk to get from Bethlehem down to Egypt to run away from Herod, who's trying to kill the child. and that, you know, they did that on foot, and then they came back, and Mary Ann leaned over to Herb and said, "You mean they had to walk that far without a McDonald's or a Tim Hortons or anything?" They're Canadian, so I'm not gonna, that's all I could do not to bust out laughing, because I can hear exactly what you said.
It's very important.
Yeah. Okay. I'm not going to read all of this, but of course, one of the tests was for God. God said to Abraham, "Take your son, your only son whom you love." I always felt like that's rubbing salt in the wound. He didn't just say, "Take Isaac." He said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, and sacrifice him to me." And it was a test. And of course, Abraham does not follow through. The Quran says that this was Ishmael.
Yeah.
And the place where the sacrifice was supposed to occur was later the site where Jerusalem was built. Okay, this is long before Jerusalem. And so you get the connection of those locations and things. When Abraham proves that he is willing to do this, they have an angel stop him, and there is a ram stuck in the bush. That animal is sacrificed, and God blesses Abraham for his faithfulness. And the faithfulness of Abraham carries all the way down into the book of Hebrews, you know, statements about that. It was Abraham was obedient to God and was counted to him as righteousness. Again, we've got Abraham, Isaac, Ishmael, Jacob, Esau, and then the restatement. We're running out of time. I'm not going to read all of these. If you want to see them, you can go online. The restatement of the covenant with Isaac, you will notice that he does say, "We'll make your people numerous. Through your offspring, all nations of the earth will be blessed." Jacob is a real little snot. He's called the heel grabber or usurper is what his name means. They were twins, Esau and Jacob. Esau came out first, and Jacob came out grabbing his heel. So technically, Esau should have been the heir because he was the oldest. Even though they're twins, he came out first. But in chapter 25, Jacob tricks his brother Esau into selling him his birthright for a bowl of lentils, basically, pottage. And then Jacob and his mother Rebecca, because he's her favorite, they trick Esau into selling, giving up the blessing so that Jacob receives the blessing from his father. And once the blessing is given, it can't be changed. Then Jacob is tricked by his uncle and father-in-law, who to work for him for 7 years in order to gain Rachel as a wife. And then they probably because he had a little bit too much to drink at the reception, he ends up instead going to bed with the nearsighted sister, and therefore is married to her. And so the father-in-law says, "Okay, now you have to work for me 7 more years to get the, you know, my daughter that you really want." Jacob, as he returns back after all of that with his two wives and he's very successful, he wrestles with God, or an angel, it's not real clear, and is renamed Israel. Israel means he who struggles with God. And Israelites the people of Israel have always taken that as a badge of honor. You know, that's why academically they're always arguing with, you know, but does God mean this or does God mean that? It's part of their nature. Later on, when Esau and Jacob are reconciled, Jacob expects Esau to still be mad at him. And it turns out that Esau has been blessed as well. He's not mad at him. He's happy to see him. And then Jacob lies to him again. He says, "You go on ahead. I'll catch up." And then he goes somewhere else. Okay. God renews his covenant with Jacob. We get, again, I'm just showing you this because all of this stuff is on. These are all the wanderings and events in Jacob's life. And finally, we do have to do this. Joseph's brothers sell him into slavery. Joseph was the 11th child of Jacob, renamed Israel, and was his favorite. And he gave him a multicolored coat, you know, so to speak. That can be translated several different ways. Joseph was always telling his brothers how he was going to be the most important and how they were all going to bow down to him, and he had dreams about how he was going to be foremost, and they got tired of it. And so they sold him to slavers that were coming through, actually traders, who were headed down into Egypt, the Midianite merchants. They take him down to Egypt, and there are some great stories about Joseph. You know, he becomes the steward and a captain of the Pharaoh's guard, and the man's wife tries to seduce him, and when he refuses to be seduced, she accuses him of trying to rape her, so they throw him in prison. He turns out he is able to interpret dreams and does great job for two guys that were in prison there. And they promise to think of, the one who survives promises to think of him when he gets out. He forgets, and then later on when the king has a vision, the guy says, hey, by the way, I remember a guy in prison. He's really good at interpreting these things. And so through a series of events, Joseph ends up being the chief operating officer, second only to Pharaoh, in running all of the affairs of Egypt, the wealthiest and most powerful country in the world. And this is basically, you know, bringing him down into Egypt. I'm sorry, I'm just flashing by these verses so that you can go back and read them, see them online. Joseph, at first, when his brothers, they have a famine in Israel, they don't have enough to eat, but because Joseph had a vision from God that there would be 7 rich years and 7 lean years in Egypt, meaning lots of food available for 7 years and then little, he set up storage houses and saved grain so that when all the rest of the Middle East was suffering a terrible famine, they still had food in Egypt. And so people were coming from different places there to buy food because they didn't have any. Jacob sends his sons down to Egypt to buy food. Joseph recognizes them, but they don't recognize Joseph. They weren't looking for, you know, basically the right-hand man of the Pharaoh to be their brother. Eventually, he reveals himself to them. He welcomes them. They're scared to death that he's going to, you know, he's going to have them killed because of what he's done. But he instead welcomes them. He says, go back and get my father. Bring him and everybody down here. We'll give you a prime place to live. They put him in Gilead, a prime location, and they are honored as long as Joseph is alive. But then Jacob dies and they take his body back. At that point the brothers go, now that our father's died, he's really going to get us. He's really going to harm us. And he has to reassure them again. In verse 19 of chapter 49, an important verse, but Joseph said to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he assured them and spoke kindly to them. Again, you can go back and read all those passages. They're all on the PowerPoint that's online. And they are fat and sassy and happy in the land in Gilead, in Egypt, being cared for. And especially they were happy to have them. The Egyptians were happy to have them there because the Israelites were herdsmen. The Egyptians needed cattle and sheep and various other kinds of herds, but they hated taking care of them. They thought that was menial work. Well, that's what the Israelites loved to do, and so the Egyptians were happy to have them there. But then, as we will find out next week, as we look into Exodus, there arose a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. Joseph dies down the road. The Pharaohs look around and go, man, we got all these people here who are foreigners, and he turns them into slaves. And that leads us to the next chapter. Any questions?
Where is this?
Oh, that's a shot of the Jordan River, looking down from an olive grove. Okay, that's just an end slide, so that's some place to go. Any questions about any of that? Do you have a sense of the flow of Genesis now,
yes,
and why it's important? Great. Yes. Thank you all very much.